I am the VP of Earned Media and Analytics at Overdrive Interactive. Overdrive Interactive is a full-service digital marketing agency. As you can see, we kind of span the globe in terms of clients, in terms of B2B or B2C. We tend to hit more of the tech B2B zone. For some reason, passion brands seem to love us. So folks like Harley, where you tattoo the brand on your forehead, the Rockettes group like those, they love what we do on the social realm, so they find us and we do fantastic things with and for them. My tech's agency of the year, we've done some pretty funky stuff and definitely kind of bend it like Beckham when it comes to digital campaigns. So I didn't know what to expect for tonight in terms of the composition of the audience, if you will. And so maybe just like a quick show of hands, who builds websites? Okay, who builds content? Fantastic. Who's here for the pizza? All right. Okay, I just was seeing if you were paying attention. Okay, so we're gonna kind of like bob and weave a little bit because I want to talk about content and the concept of findability. But we're going to kind of talk about two realms of SEO and your site. One is code and accessibility, and then the other aspect is content. The floor is open. If you have questions, if there's something that you're not sure of or don't understand or haven't seen, ask. We'll get into it, or we'll just plow ahead. So, you know, from a process standpoint, I think you really got to think about any of these programs as processes. You know, we look at the discovery aspect first, trying to figure out exactly what, don't even bother taking pictures. The slides are all available for you. Don't worry about it. But if you want to take pictures of me, we'll talk about that later. So the idea here is that there's a process, right? There's a beginning, a middle, an end, and then there's the iteration and you kind of wash, rinse, repeat, right? And so it's really understanding who you are, what you are, or what you're trying to aspire towards, and then definitely, you know, there's a competitive set, right? There's nothing that's like completely new that you're going to be doing. Surely somebody is doing something similar, and how are they doing it, and where are they showing up? And if you take these categorical terms, forget the brand stuff, forget the, you know, kind of, you know, your niche, what you've kind of like called it, like what does everybody else call it, right? So we had Dennis and Avery as a client. And they called it an interior state mandated something, but all of you know it as your registration sticker, right? And your inspection sticker, and that's what you call it. And they were calling it completely different. So people would go on their site and they would be looking for this thing that didn't exist because what you call it versus what they call it. So it's that internal speak versus the external speak, right? And so this goes to your keyword strategy and kind of like keeping it all like very, very categorical. You know, you got the head terms. You know, you're not going to rank for the term cloud, nor do you really want to, right? Because either you're cloud the weather or you're cloud the computing aspect of it, right? So you think about where you sit in the realm. You're not going to rank for cloud. I mean, it's just reality, right? But you may rank for cloud computing, and you certainly may rank for cloud the weather. It's all about benchmarking. If it's a brand new site, your benchmark is basically zero, and that's okay. You can only go up. However, you know, if you've been in it for a while and you're frustrated because you don't see traction and you're not coming up, but you see your competitors coming up, you know, this is where we want to start asking questions, why and what are you doing? And we're going to address all that too. There's on-site optimization, there's off-site optimization. And then there's conversion optimization, right? Just because you get the user to your page doesn't mean that they actually do something. And there's a reason for that. And we're going to get into that. So SEO is made up of what I like to think of as four pillars. There's the technical aspect of it. There's the content aspect of it. There's the stuff that's happening offsite, right? And I want you to think of, you know, the social process, if you will, and these social platforms. They're nothing more than websites. They're websites where your stuff can live, potentially, right? And then there's apps. And apps are a huge thing and something to be taken into consideration. So let's talk about this eye chart here. You know, how do people find your stuff, this concept of findability? And so if I was to draw this Venn diagram for you, the first big circle would be search. And search encompasses two concepts. There's organic search and paid search. But at the end of the day, it's this beachfront real estate called the Google search engine result page. And how much of that do you own, right? That's the first aspect of it. The second aspect of it is social, right? And we call these platforms the, you know, these social media outlets, you know, and Facebook and LinkedIn and stuff. You need to build what we call a social fortress, right? So you're going to get your LinkedIn page, you're going to get your Facebook page, you're going to get your Google Plus page, and you're going to build that aspect of it. And then lastly, there's the app aspect of it and your site at large, because that's a property that you own and you can control. And so when you look at this Venn diagram and the overlap, all these pieces have to work together, and you have to feed the beast. And that beast are the search engines, and they want to see that you're developing new content and that you're publishing all the time, and that people are coming to your site and they're loving you and they're embracing you and they like you and all this other grand stuff, right? If you want to learn more about what findability is and what it means to you, feel free to go to the website address that you can't see at the bottom of the screen. But it's the last blog, it's like a 3,000 word blog post. It's called The Miracle of Findability. Again, the slides will be available for you. They're already up on SlideShare. You can download them at your leisure. But then we, you know, talk a lot about Google. Who knows what the second top search engine is?
YouTube.
Thank you for playing. All right. But really, what defines a search engine? So I got kids, right? And you know, sure enough, one of them starts, their head's spinning around, and they're puking green in the middle of the night, and I'm thinking, oh, Christ. And so I'm on WebMD. I'm like, oh, you know, I'm thinking the worst. You know, all these are search engines at some level, right? When you go to find something, you know, on food or all recipes, and you know, when you go to, you know, finance and you're looking at Yahoo as your stocks are crashing or going up or whatever it is, you know, Pandora, and you're looking for, you know, light jazz. They're all search engines at some point, right? Anybody know what A9 is? Not major, not minor, just A9.
Say Amazon.
Ding, ding, ding. Right. That's Amazon's search engine that they built ages ago. But Amazon Suggest and all that other stuff when you're searching on their website, that's how they cut their teeth on it, right? And that's why it's a good user. Well, it is a good user experience now, but that's why you have a better experience with it. And so search engines can live in all these different buckets, but, you know, there's other things that are happening, and the engines are trying to co-opt the experience of driving you to a site and becoming answer engines, right? And so when you look at this kind of exhaustive list, if you will, I personally never spell correctly because I got fat fingers and I just let the digits fly, right? And so I've got autocorrect on anything that I type, right? So you got spelling suggestions. You got autocomplete. It's already finishing my thought. Oh, how did it know I wanted the fuzzy slippers? Then you've got the whole related, you know, searches. Well, you know, you're kind of looking for this, but other people were looking for that. You know, maybe you're looking for something different. You got the calculator. Just Google, you know, mortgage calculator. The calculator shows right up in the screen. You don't end up going to Bankrate or any of these other sites. Google just, you know, took all of that traffic from Bankrate. On and on and on. You get the general idea. You can do the comparative analysis. I highly recommend you Google sharks versus crocodiles. It's fascinating. But the long story short is the odds of you getting somebody to your site continue to diminish based on the information that you're providing and these engines are kind of packaging, right? So what are we going to learn today? Hopefully, what we're going to convey to you is how to boost your search engine presence, right? How to get your sites found, and ultimately, how to turn your website pages into great SEO pages. And so, you know, I'm not trying to make you into an SEO analyst, and it's certainly not to make your jobs harder. However, it is for you to understand what your organization's terms are. And that's a really kind of amorphous concept, right? You know, terms, what's a term, right? We talk about keywords, we talk about core keywords and target keywords. But at the end of the day, what we're trying to do is we're trying to access the critical moment, right? And this is a Googleism. It's all about targeting and timing. So the lights went out in Hartford, power out, my folks are there, their freezer's gonna crap out, they got all this food in there, it's like, oh man, you know, and it's been out for days now, right? Ice storm, this is only like a couple years ago. And so they're like, oh, what do we do? I was like, well, why don't you guys go get some dry ice and stock, you know, the freezer with the dry ice and you'll be good to go. Well, we're not too sure what to get. So I'm driving and I just do Hartford, Connecticut, dry ice, right? Right then and there, right on my phone, I'm like, here's the phone number, go call them. That is targeting and that is timing. I'm in Boston, my folks are in Connecticut, they need dry ice, I'm on the fly, I'm going to say I'm going 60. But the point is, that's what targeting timing is. It answered the question, delivered the information. Why are we so focused on SEO? We are so focused on SEO because it drives the highest ROI. You can apply dollars to paid search. You put a dollar in, it goes on, that dollar's gone, it's off, right? So you gotta continue to pump money into that. SEO is more evergreen. You paid for that New York Times editor to write that article for you. It is brilliant. It's 1,500 words long. It's fantastic. It's deep. It's authoritative. It not only lives today, it lives tomorrow and the day after. And time again, we go into these companies and we see that this blog post from 2011 is their most popular blog post and people just love it. It's still, you know, meaningful, it's still good information. And so you need to think about the energy and the effort that you're putting into this. You know, don't shortcut it, right? You gotta go for the gold here. So we're used to the old paradigm, 10 blue links, you Google something, it comes up, ta-da. Well, it's not true today. The right rail paid search ads are gone. It's been replaced by the knowledge graph. And so you've got paid search results. And so what happens is your organic results just went like this, womp, by a factor of 4, because now it's 4 paid search results. So pay to play, right? That's part of your campaign strategy. And then you've got what we call blended results. You've got what we call the snack pack, right? You've got these local results that kind of give you, okay, I got a pizza place here, or I got my dry ice over there, right? And it could be news, could be video, could be images, could be all kinds of stuff that shows up in carousels. It's fantastic now, especially in the mobile experience. And then you've got your natural results, right? And this is what we're trying to drive for you. And then lastly, you've got the knowledge graph. And the knowledge graph, as I mentioned before, you know, the engines are really trying to become answer engines, and they're trying to become this repository of information. So you'll see, if you can see, it's kind of small, but you'll see, like, in this Veracode example, this company, they've got their social profiles are in there. And oh, by the way, people also searched for, and there's an address, and there's a description of what they do, right? You need to fill all this information out. Go get your Google Plus page, fill it all out. Yes, Google Plus still exists. And fill it all out, right? And this is where they're dragging some of their information from. We're also going to get into structured markup, and we're going to talk about things versus strings, and we're going to explain how you do that on your site as well. But again, going back, it's not just about Google, right? It's stunning. We were looking at a client site, and like Pinterest was the number one referrer, and I was like, who'd have thunk it? But they have, and they're a credit card company, but they have all these like how-tos kind of thing, like how to plan a cheap vacation and all this, and they put it up on Pinterest, and it links back to their site, and people are clicking off. It was fascinating. So the two areas of SEO that we're going to talk about tonight are broken into two buckets. The first bucket is code and site structure, what we consider to be indexing and accessibility, and the second is going to be content and copy enhancement. And when I talk to SEO people, they usually fall in one of these two buckets, and I call them bit flippers or Scrabble players. Bit flippers just intrinsically understand and for the coders in the room, they understand HTML5, they understand CSS3, they understand kind of the, you know, the head goes here, the footer goes there, you know, they look at the code and they can instantly understand, you know, you didn't end the argument and that's why everything is broken, and that's why it's rendering improperly, or you're blocking your JavaScript and it's all kind of messed up. And then there's the Scrabble players. And Scrabble players just intrinsically understand semantics, right? And I think this is something that you need to consider. You know, you don't need to write content for what we call stemming, the plural, the ing, the er version of these terms, because the search engines get that, right? And these Scrabble players just are really good at developing these kind of bodies of clusters in terms of keywords that belong together. And we're going to talk about keyword clustering a little bit further on as well. So let's talk about the ABCs of SEO, right? Because I got kids, so everything kind of drills down to like this Barney moment. So A is for accessibility. Your site has to be accessible. If the search engines cannot index it, if the user cannot navigate through it, right, it's useless, right? It's dead to them. So there's got to be an accessibility factor. The second is, I talked about deep authoritative content. You need breadth of content. And we're going to go back to the keyword clustering and you'll see what I'm talking about. But, you know, if you really want to be the authority on the subject, you know, you were talking about your beer publisher before, they're not going to have one article on IPAs. They're not going to have one article on stouts. They're going to have stouts across the world and 300 of them compared to each other, right? It's interesting that the breadth of content is really a determining factor in how the engines rank you. Now, we're going to take a slight pause because I want to talk about trust, popularity, and authority. There's a difference between breadth of content and the popularity of the site. So TMZ is not my go-to source necessarily for world news, but it is definitely popular. Right? So from an authority standpoint, it's kind of low. From a trust standpoint, it's kind of low. But popularity, it's wicked high. So again, it's three things that the engines are looking at to determine whether you're going to show up or not, right? And then lastly is consistency. And by consistency, what I mean is that if you're going to talk about stouts, porters, IPAs, anytime you're talking about them, that you have these keywords. And then you have what we call a preferred landing page. So this keyword is linked to this page, and there is an intrinsic relationship. Quizongo?
A question about breadth of content. Are you seeing specifically that having a large amount of content around a particular topic, as an individual, many individual URLs, each with their own unique content, that by itself is a signal that search engine cycles are looking for? Or is it more that having a large number of URLs around a particular topic, all of which are pointing links back to that higher level category that is related to that topic, that that's what's driving that as a factor?
Right, so that's slide 300. We're not there yet. No, but seriously, it's a combination of those things, right? So we're going to get into like the whole Wikipedia and why it ranks, even though all their links are no index. But it's a combination of that, right? So it's the breadth of content, or certainly the amount of URLs. But then it's relational, right? And this is where the structure comes into place, and understanding that this links into this and this links into this. So again, think of Wikipedia. Anytime you go to a Wikipedia article, there's like probably 100 blue anchor text links going to another Wikipedia page, right? And think of those links as fibrous material and really gluing all that together, so you get a strong bond and cohesion in relationship to the overall site of the, you know, structure, one. Two, but categorically, as you were saying before, you know, as we kind of, you know, folderize, right? So I'm at the root, but now one folder deep, I'm two folders deep. Don't go more than three folders deep ever. There's no need for it. You know, and so as you go up into the food chain to, you know, and this goes back to navigation, what are the most important pieces of the navigation? Are you using keywords in your navigation, right? You know, mortgage calculator, is that, you know, the keyword that actually clicks on the button that takes you to the mortgage calculator, right? It's that stuff. So, you know, we've talked about keywords a lot, and so it's literally about the keywords. I'm not kidding you. So the keyword is how the search engines understand what you're talking about at some level and at a very high degree. And it doesn't really matter whether it's typed or spoken. Who's got one of those Alexa dots? Dumbest goddamn thing I ever bought. What's their Fire Stick, right? So I got the Fire Stick at the house, and I bring the dot in, and I'm all excited, and I plug the dot next to in the TV room, and I'm like, Alexa, join, right? Find my Fire Stick. And it's like, oh, you've got one, but I'm sorry, it's not Bluetooth enabled, and we won't connect it. I'm like, what's this IoT thing? It sucks. And then I asked her a whole bunch of questions, and then finally my 9-year-old just said, Alexa, thank you. And then Alexa went for like 20 iterations of your welcomes, and he thought that was hilarious, and I said, it's out of here. So you know, again, going back to this discovery process of what your keywords should be, you want to look at your competitive data, right? You want to look at your current site analytics. If you have site search enabled on your website, look to see what people are looking for once they hit your site. Incognito, everybody knows how to use Incognito, Chrome browser or whatever it is, kind of, yeah, no?
Yeah.
Okay, you raised your hand. You were the only one, so.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I thought I heard you say how many know how.
Oh, how many know how? All right. See, now you're good. So because you're cookied, right? So you don't want to kind of make it so that it's an unfair competition. You really want the information. And we keep talking about all this stuff and how we're going to like juice the site and add octane and all this stuff. But the truth of the matter is the audience is not an algorithm. You have to write for the audience. Now, the audience may only read the first 3 bullets on your page of 1,500 words, but the search engines are certainly going to read the rest of it, right? But you got to write for the audience, and the audience is not an algorithm. So let's talk about your universe. You need to figure out what your universe is about. And there's a lot of different ways to do keyword research. And again, the deck is already on SlideShare for you. I'll show you where it is. But I'm going to give you a few hints as to how to do this, right? So one of the places I really like is called ubersuggest.io. And basically what it does is it goes in, it takes all the Google auto completes and suggests, and you put in something like content management. I don't know if you can see it or not, but I got content management application, an assistant, an API, and solutions, and on and on and on and on. And so I put one concept in, and it spun out literally hundreds of variations on the theme, right? And so you look at this and you say, oh, okay, this is applicable or this is completely useless to me. Content management for social media, that doesn't apply to what I do, right? I'm building a CMS. I'm not building something with a social extension on it. The other site that I really like is Answer the Public. The reason I like Answer the Public is they've gone a step further. And if you recall, I said earlier that Google wants to be the answer engine. How many of you like go in and go, best pizza, or how do I, or where do I, or hopefully there's no whys, but it goes in and it starts to catalog all this now into the who, what, why, when, where's, because that's what people are actually searching for. That's what you need to answer. And so there's a special box called Quick Answers. We call it Position Zero in Google. And it's that little box that comes up. Usually they take it out of Wikipedia or some other website. And it kind of gives you the instant answer. And sometimes if you Google like how to make fettuccine, it'll give you like the first 4 steps. And there's ways to mark that up on your website. And we'll talk about that as well. But this is really important because how, the are, the where, the which, the who. Those answer some bigger categorical questions and are really important. And oh, by the way, if you do it right and you do your searches, if you're looking to develop a blogging calendar and you want to know about what you should be blogging about Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and a year from now, I went into a client's and like within 20 minutes, I had 300 blog post titles. And they were like, what? I was like, yup. And this is what people are looking for. So since this is what people are looking for, why aren't you writing about what they're looking for? this is like the heads up, right? This is like even better than trying to figure out what to get your wife for her birthday. It like tells you, by the way, guys, appliances didn't work. So you know, great blog post titles, you know, this whole what a content management system does, all this stuff, it'll give you the idea of what you should be doing. And so, again, a fantastic resource. And there's some creepy guy picking his teeth. You'll see that there it says the UK over on the right. If you click the UK, you can switch the destination, so it can do US, it can do Germany. So if you're multilingual or doing things for clients in other languages, you can flip the languages as well. Then you got the Google auto suggest, right? You start typing in content management, it kind of gives you, and then if you hit the answer, and you go all the way to the bottom, it gives you usually somewhere between 6 to 8, sometimes 10 other variations on, you know, people also searched for kind of stuff. All right. So relevance, popularity, probability, right? We talked about cloud computing versus cloud, the weather. So you want to be relevant. Make sure the terms that you're using are relevant to what you're doing. Popularity. You know, again, you're not going to rank for cloud, and you can figure out what the search frequency volumes are on these things. You know, you want to be able to win the war that you're going to win, and then there's popularity. If you take this, like, 5 to 10 word phrase that nobody's looking for, you will absolutely rank for it, and nobody will ever get to your website because nobody's looking for it. That one person a year that's going to come to you, mazel tov, it did you nothing. So think about how this kind of goes into your strategy as well. So again, you know, don't use the branded terms, the vernacular kind of stuff, you know, act like a prospect. I told you about the inspection sticker kind of stuff, and really start to think about how this all goes. And so I think this, to the gentleman in the back that asked this question earlier, when we look at the world like this, right, when we look at something like penetration testing or code security or agile testing, look at penetration testing and look at all the different concepts under penetration testing, right? So to your question, if you're building content out and I've got 10 different pages or however many pages that represents, and they're all talking about penetration testing and open source vulnerabilities, but on that page I can use multiple keywords, but I'm all linking back up to this main page of penetration testing, you're passing juice, right? That fibrous material is passing juice, and you're directing the engines that categorically, this is really what I'm talking about up here, even though I'm dealing with a sub-level topic down here. Yes? Everybody got that? Nice. All right. Let's put it into a picture because it's easier to tell this way, right? I want to rank for logistics, which is just about as bad as saying I want to rank for the term cloud. It is not going to happen, right? So what I've done here is I said, I really want to rank for the term logistics, but I'm going to talk about logistics ROI and best practices and FAQs and white papers and all these other things that I can think about around logistics. And again, I'm going to build that fibrous material, right? Because I'm going to talk about logistics and I'm going to link it all back to that one page, and the engines are going to understand this is the top page for this website. Now, whether you're going to rank for logistics or not, we'll debate that later, right? It takes a long time and a lot of work. This is not a sprint, it is a marathon. But this is how it goes. So going back to your linking question, apples, oranges, bananas, I got great apples, I got Granny Smiths, I got Northern Spies, I got Cortlands, I got Macintosh. I can go all day on apples, believe me. So the long story short is when we start linking these all together, right? It's okay that I'm talking about apples, but I'm also talking about bananas, and it kind of links back and forth, right? But at the top level, I'm talking about apples or bananas, right? But I'm talking about all these different types, and again, linking them back together. So what makes a good link? Let's talk about that briefly. So, you know, I'd rather have one link from the Wall Street Journal or the New York Times versus 100 links from some mom's blog. Nothing against mom's blogs, but, you know, if it's kind of like my kid uses, you know, Pampers, it's like enough. So you go in, you say, okay, great. .gov's very authoritative, .edu's very authoritative, right? You got all these different websites that you're getting links from. You know, you're building this content, you're casting your seeds to the wind, right? You've got a PR team, or you're doing some social media, and you're boosting your posts on LinkedIn, and hopefully somebody recognizes your hard work, and they talk about you and link back to you, and that's fantastic, right? But we really want to look at the sites that have juice, right? And so IBM or Symantec or the New York Times, those are reputable sources, right? Again, trust, popularity, authority. You want places that, you know, really have deep authority. And so a link is fantastic. Again, going back to that example before about, you know, Agile and SDLC and pen testing, you know, when I look at test.com or sample.gov, you know, and I've got these terms, penetration testing, you know, that's really what I'm looking for in terms of, getting the links, is using those terms on those sites back to me. So I don't want just, you know, my company name. I want to be known for this and linked back to you. Everybody understand that? Because it's a little squirrely in terms of the concept, right? I don't want to be linked for Jeff Selig. I want to be linked for SEO Grandmaster, right? If there's such a title. So let's talk about how linking works and kind of wrap up the whole linking thing. Who has their own website? Great. Who has more than one website? Who has a microsite? Okay. So you absolutely have control over your own website. So any content that you develop on your own website, you can create another page, and you can take this core concept, and you can link it back over to this other page, and there's a blog post that you wrote in 2011, and you go back in, and you change it, and you add some keyword insertion, and you go, oh, this is a good opportunity, I finally understand what this is about, and you sync a link, and it's all fantastic, right? You have control over your destiny. The next level is what we call interdivisional. So I asked if you had multiple websites, and some of you said yes. Well, you don't want to kind of do this kind of back and forth thing. Maybe you'll link from one to the other. You don't want to do this reciprocal kind of thing. You know, it's not such a great idea, but maybe a link here, maybe a link there. You know, the microsites, you've got a special campaign, and you bought a domain, and you built something, and you kind of link here, and you're going to, like, here's the parent company, it links back here. That's fantastic. And then you have the next layer, which you have less control over, which is external. This is actually where we're trying to go, right? Once you've built your fortress and you're really happy with your own website, you want to start looking at other people's websites, right? And so any PR that you're doing, any social media that you're doing, again, Facebook is just a website where your crap lives. Most of it is crap, right? But it lives there. LinkedIn, certainly a higher value proposition. And, you know, kind of, if you're in Reddit and posting, there's a value proposition there as well. So you heard me talk about keywords and pages, and this is how it kind of shakes out, right? So you saw I had penetration testing, vulnerability scanning, but the question is, what is the page that you want to define as being the page you want to rank? And this is a very, very important question, and also something that you need to think about, like, before you build it, or if it's already built, like, what's actually ranking if that's the page that you want? And maybe by de facto you go, okay, I'll take it. But I got CWE at the top here, and I got CWE Sans Top 25. Is it my favorite page? No, but it's ranking, I'll take it. You notice that, you know, I'm very clear about folders. You know, I've got a whole folder just on security, right? So all my security concepts are going in that security bucket. And so you can label these folders at the top level, these keywords, right? Again, not cloud, but cloud computing or cybersecurity or what have you. But it kind of like sections these things off, right? And so you want this intrinsic relationship between the keyword and your preferred landing page, and then you kind of put it all together, and it's fantastic. So how do I use them? I knew you were going to ask that, young man. So do focus on creating value, right? You know, infuse your core target terms into your pages. Do not stuff the keywords. Do not spam decks. Do not spin content. Do not hire on Fiverr somebody to rip you off because they took it out of Wikipedia and they morphed a few words around, right? Really good stuff. And so I mentioned the New York Times editor before. So I have a friend, and he has a home improvement website. And this particular site that he has is about roofing shingles. And he literally spent $1,500 for a New York Times level editor to write him an article about it. And it got picked up by a .gov site, and crazy traffic. He has made his $1,500 back in spades. So don't worry about it. The investment will pay off, but you got to make the investment. All right, enough of this. Let's go forward on how this actually looks. So you've got your web page, right? Well, let's talk about the elements of that web page. You've got a title. You've got your URL. You got your H1 tags, your H2 tags. Hopefully you've got some images with alt text, and then you've got your body copy. You got your CTAs. You got your footer related, and then you've got the subcategory stuff. 10 minutes. All right, 30 more slides. So, focus on the description, right? And we're going to zoom ahead a little bit, but you know, the objective of the copy is to get a good keyword rich piece of content out there, right? And so, it's really important stuff. It's what people read. It establishes the page as the authority on that topic. Again, like I said, humans may not read every word, but the engines do. Body copy length, 500 plus words, keyword density, 1 to 2 uses per every 100 words, right? And it's not the same keyword. Again, think of that clustering, all those keywords that are in that bucket. And if you don't have a keyword from that list, it's a variation on the theme, right? It's okay. Again, I'm going to make the slides available to you, so we'll just kind of zoom ahead. Great. Title tags, let's get to the good stuff. All right, so why am I so focused on titles and meta descriptions and URLs? Because that's what you see in the search engine result pages. And you can influence the click. Yes, you have the power to influence the click. Benefits, offers, calls to action. So let's see how this plays out. I Googled password hacking, right? And there you go, password hacking, Veracode. And oh, by the way, look at the URL. It's under security, password hacking. Do you see how password hacking is bolded? That's the term that I searched for. I searched for password hacking, and oh, by the way, it's in bold, right? And again, you'll see password hacking again in bold underneath. But then you've got your meta description. Who does meta descriptions when they write their blog posts? All right, everybody, that's great. No, you really should do it. Because that's what shows up in the SERPs. If you don't do it, Google's going to make it up for you. And that's not necessarily what you want, right? And so again, this is your opportunity to write what you want to convince the user to click through. And so my cocktail talk is, you know, I build things on websites that people click. Right? We use a bunch of neuroscience and colors and shapes and language to influence the click in a very creepy way, but I own it. So it's cool. It's all right, right? This is what you're trying to do. This alone, if there's nothing else that you get out of tonight, choosing keywords that make sense and working on this stuff when you make posts, you're in good shape. So meta titles, meta tags, you know, it's a clear understanding of what the page is. Your website is not a book. Each page of your website is a book. So think of your website as an entire shelf. And so the meta description of what that page is about is literally a description of the book. And the title is the title of the book, right? Think way deeper. You're going to pick a whole bunch of keywords. You're going to associate them with the page. You're going to write some tags. It's going to be fantastic. Title tags, you can read as well as I can. Don't worry about the contact us pages. And stuff like that. It's really the pages that you're trying to get people to get to. Meta descriptions, keyword meta tag. I'll just pause on the keyword meta tag. We still use it. Most of our clients are international. Google deprecated using keyword tags. We understand that. However, to put your thoughts together, 8 to 12 terms in the keyword tags to organize your thoughts, 6 to 8 of those being from your core target group, and the rest can be, you know, words that just are kind of associated with the concept of what you're writing. Baidu, Yen, Next Neighbor, still use them. And we've actually seen them in the wild in the Google search results. So even though Google says they don't use them, they show up sometimes, and so it kind of makes you wonder what they're actually doing. So the bottom line is, you have four elements that you can control: titles, headlines, descriptions, and the body copy. Really important. These are the rules of thumb. Stick with it. Again, you can download the slides later. So themes, right? So there's SEO-friendly themes. Some of you are developers. You're developing your own themes. If you're not, there's a whole host of themes that are out there that are SEO-friendly and were designed with that in mind. You can see there's a link at the bottom. You can go find them for yourself, decide which ones you like, you know, whether it's two column, one column, whatever the style is. Permalinks. Everybody set their permalinks to custom structure? Of course you did. If you didn't, do it. Highly recommend it. You don't need post 1039. It doesn't really say anything to the user. Internal linking, right? There's a whole bunch of stuff. There's plugins. You can say keywords that link to this page. You can do it automatically. I don't necessarily recommend it. I've done it before as tests. It works. But I think handcrafted is way better, right? And then certainly that whole associating the keyword with the landing page. SEO plugins, they're good. They all kind of work, right? All-in-One and Yoast are probably the ones we come across the most. The whole red light, green light concept, if you got the yellow light, that's okay. You know, your page isn't going to die, but you want to try to hit the mark as much as possible. We talked about things, not strings, and structured markup. RankBrain and Hummingbird are two Google algorithms. You know, the AI and the synonyms kind of like going together, really important. You know, there's Twitter cards, there's YouTube cards, schema data, right? And then, of course, it wouldn't be good if Facebook didn't jump into the mix and create a whole new protocol called Open Graph. But again, it's structured markup, and so entities are really important, and I want you to think about entities. And so you have a business, and it has a location, and you have a founder, and you have events, and all these are things. Everybody, you know, kind of goes through going back to the all recipe concept, right? 5 stars. Why would I bake something that's 3 stars? So, you know, this is kind of what it affects. Again, here's a list of plugins for you. Performance, right? You want to be able to make sure you've got analytics. You can see direct traffic, organic traffic, referral. But the truth of the matter is, if you've got a site that's more industrial and you've got people that are building content for you, why don't you look to see how those authors are performing? So if you're paying someone to write content for you, or you're paying like the Skywords of the world to write content for you, and someone's been writing posts for you for a year, start looking at how their performance is. Does one author perform better than another author? And why, right? And which posts are performing better? The sources, where are they coming from? Are they coming organically? Are they coming from social media? Who knows? You'll find out. Questions?
So let's say you have a business with multiple services. On your homepage, do you, I have a problem where on my homepage I have a lot of services listed, and that's where all the Google traffic is going. On those sub-services, there's a lot more content, but it's not being, those homepages don't go up on the search. So is that what you want? Do you want to have one page concentrated with all the services, or do you want to have a homepage that's more bare compared to other pages?
So I don't know about the bear part, but I definitely, no matter where the user goes, I want them to have a good experience. So if you can be very specific about like the services that you're offering, or deeper, you know, sub, you know, going back to the H1 versus H2, H3, like if you write an outline, right, and this is what I do, and this is, you know, the next thing I do, and kind of like structure it like that, and then start building those pages out, and then on every page have, you know, some offer, some call to action, you know, download my white paper on this because, you know, it'll show you more, or here's a calculator or whatever. You need to just continuously build content out and then link it together and structure your site. Breadcrumbs are fantastic too, right, to go back depending on how the services are laid out. So there's a host of ways to kind of, you know, structurally lay that out.
Is it that redundant?
It's not bad to be affirmative. It's bad to be duplicative. All right, rock on. So if you go to this website, slideshare.net, right, and you go to OVRDRV, which is short for Overdrive Interactive, it's called SEO for WordPress dash whatever. If you just go to OVRDRV on SlideShare, you'll probably find it. The whole deck is sitting there waiting for you. My contact information is somewhere. You know, feel free to reach out. You can certainly find me on Twitter, SEO SEM. I'm around. Feel free to ping me. Thank you so much. You've been a great audience, and good job.